Hello and welcome to Big Picture. I'm Vishal Dahiya, and today we're going to talk about good governance. Now, December 25th is former Prime Minister, late Atal Bihari Vajpayee's birthday, and it is marked as Good Governance Day every year. We'll try and look at the life and times of former Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee, as well as the reason why we celebrated as Good Governance Day and what is exactly being done there. For more on this, we're joined by a distinguished panel of guests. Let me first introduce them to you, beginning with Mr. Shekhar Iyer, senior journalist who is with us. We also have Mr. Ashok Tandon, another senior journalist who spent a lot of time with former Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And we also have with us Mr. Shakti Sinha, director of Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute of International Studies in Vadodara. And he has also recently written a book on Atal Bihari Vajpayee's tenure as Prime Minister. Welcome, all of you gentlemen, to Rajya Sabha Television. Let me begin with you, Mr. Tandon, since you have had a very close association with the former Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee. Let's try and understand the correlation between Atal Bihari Vajpayee's career or term as Prime Minister and the good governance concept.
Actually, if you look back, Mr. Vajpayee's good governance, first glimpse we got when he was the External Affairs Minister in 1977 Morarji Desai government. He made a mark as External Affairs Minister of India, and that was very widely recognized across the globe. And wherever he traveled, and so he made a mark, including his maiden speech in Hindi at the United Nations. All these things put together, so he had, made a mark towards good governance in his first inning as the External Affairs Minister. Now, when he was chairman of the parliamentary PAC, Public mm-hmm. Accounts Committee, he again made a mark as an administrator. So now when we come to the three innings of Mr. Vajpayee as the Prime Minister, 13 days in 1996 and 13 months in 1998, and then subsequently, of course, 1999 to 2004, there is a series of events which we can count. I think to begin with, it would be ideal that the Pokhran nuclear test, that was also a marvel of Vajpayee government's achievements. Mm-hmm. And it was against all odds, and the way the Indian scientists and technicians, they all camouflaged the whole thing and deceived the Western satellite mechanism and all that, which were keeping an eye on India nuclear test. So all that also goes to the credit of Mr. Vajpayee's government, and mm-hmm. can be, and I think should be included as part of the good governance. Then series of measures which were introduced subsequently, whether it was Golden Quadrilateral National Highway Scheme or Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, a series of measures were taken for the welfare of the society, downtrodden, all sections of the society. So all these things put together, it was very aptly, declared as a good governance day by the Narendra Modi government.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me bring in Mr. Sinha. Your book, which has come out recently, is titled The Years That Changed India. So if you could, take us through what kind of changes are you talking about? And looks like good governance, as Mr. Tandon was pointing out, is one very important aspect here, which seems to have stuck with us in terms of the change, which apparently you're referring to.
The point is, good governance is a very interesting point because there are various ways to look at it. And what I'm not going into detail in this book is that in terms of economic decision making, in terms of simplifying things for business, in terms of liberalizing the economy so that investment could flow in, the entire entrepreneurial talent could get an opportunity to break out. That was very, very important. And in fact, going back to Mr. Vajpayee's tenure as the foreign minister, it was for the first time that steps were taken to simplifying the issuance of passports. Otherwise, in the 70s, even later on, was considered a major achievement getting a passport. This was the first time somebody articulated and tried to simplify the process of getting passports. Mm-hmm. And so come on to the later tenure card in my book, when you think that, look at the telecom policy, which was meant to not just rescue the sector, but make cell phones more easily available to people. Till then, firms looked at a luxury. Actually, for the self-employed, the vegetable vendor, mm-hmm. the plumber, the electrician, these are the people, the small farmer who decides to sell her produce, not in her village, but in a village 10 kilometers away. To all that, I think these were not just simple matter of economic reforms, but at the core of it was making easier for people to live a more productive life. So I would look at good governance in that sense of changing things for the better. Not a revolution, but incrementally changing things for the better to improve the quality of life of our people.
Okay. So taking governance to the people's doorstep and making them realize that these are the benefits which people can, avail of as far as government schemes are concerned. That seemingly was the high point. Let's bring in Mr. Shekhar Iyer here as well. Mr. Iyer, from your experience of those days this concept of good governance, which we are talking about, seemingly as both the gentleman, Mr. Tandon, and Mr. Sinha is pointing out, a lot was done then, sort of ground was laid and the foundation sort of was made very strong at that point in time.
Well, Vishalji, you must understand that Vajpayee took over at a time when, Narasimha Rao's liberalization era, that is between 91 and 96, had, rather tapered off. And then you had a period when in 96, Vajpayee was given an opportunity to form the government, but the numbers could not be mustered. And then you saw a period of a coalition era in which the Congress was in the driver's seat. A Congress which was not actually controlled by Narasimha Rao, a different Congress. So those 2 years, 1 year of Gujarat and 1 year of Devgowda and 1 year of Gujarat, it led to a situation, I would say, a kind of a paralysis in the system. Mm-hmm. So therefore, when Vajpayee took over, the first thing that I noticed as a person outside the government, as a journalist covering that period, was Vajpayee immediately speeded up the mood of liberalization. Right from the beginning go, despite great difficulties in managing the alliance, the National Democratic Alliance, you had a first phase from 98 to 99, which Mr. Shakti Sinha has very beautifully described the kind of pressure that came in his latest book. Then subsequently from 99 to 2004, during this period of 6 years, a lot of things in terms of delivery, in terms of decision making, and in terms of actual achievement on the ground, mm-hmm. whether it is quadrilateral highways or the telecom thing, or for instance, disinvestment process. In all this, there was transparency. And the great thing, I think, about Vajpayee's administration was Vajpayee was a person who held his own views till the last minute, heard everyone, and finally gave the answer, yes or no. And mm-hmm. after that, the system, there was no point of looking back. And the manner in which he was able to get everybody along and on board, thanks to his the kind of ministers he had, as well as his own leadership and the kind of confidence people had in his word and in his action. I think that represented a good governance. Vishal.
Okay. Mr. Tandon, would you, agree to this point here, as, Mr. Iyer is pointing out, that striking a balance between these two things, one, ensuring a political stability as well, because let's not forget he was leading a coalition government at that point in time as well, and ensuring, these liberal reforms be again put on track, ensuring good governance, making the benefits of the government policies reach the common people. So that was a sort of a very difficult, task, but he fulfill that very clearly and very beautifully there as well.
Let's not forget that the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan campaign, which was launched during Vajpayee's government by Dr. Murali Manohar Joshi, the subsequent UPA one could not find any fault in it and was literally forced to continue with that. That, I think, is a very great achievement. But I must say that the good governance chapter also goes back to the days post-Pokhran test, because the kind of sanctions which were imposed on India, economic sanctions were imposed by all superpowers, and the way India's foreign policy under Vajpayee handled those situations, the trying time, and brought everything back on the rail in the international arena, that also is part of the good governance. And then when we come to the Kargil war and conflict, the way it was handled both at the diplomatic level, also at the military level and the Air Force level, and the entire nation stood behind him. Mind you, Vajpayee was heading a caretaker government when Kargil took place. Apparently, Pakistan thought that he must be a weak leader now because he has lost a vote of confidence, and they took the right time. But the way the entire nation stood behind him, the way our armed forces handled the situation, vacated the aggression, and also at the same time, at our diplomatic level, Vajpayee had given instructions to Air Force not to cross the LOC. And the way whole thing was handled, and India won that war, and subsequently the people also rewarded him with another mandate. So this also is in a sequence of the good governance. So there are a whole lot of measures, apart from the economic measures which Shakti Sinha was talking about, and also the socio-economic transformation, the initiatives which were taken. And also, let's not forget that whatever the economic achievements of Vajpayee government were, UPA first literally, you know, harvested that. They took full advantage of that, because the whole economy was put on the rail. It was on track when the Vajpayee government lost in 2004. And the UPA one continued to hit the harvest for the next 5 years. Mm-hmm. So I think on the socio-economic front, on political front, as Shekhar was saying, you know, today it looks very easy that Modi government has got an absolute majority of its own. But look at the period which Vajpayee was heading. And there was a coalition, there was divergent opinion, views, and also the tantrums of some of the coalition partners. All those things put together, handling and providing a political stability for 5 years in itself is an example of good governance.
Okay, definitely. That indeed is an example of a worthy political leader and an administrator, as well as Mr. Tandon is pointing out. Mr. Shakti Sinha, I'd like to come back to you, and in your initial response, you spoke about how, you know, his policies were for the welfare of the common man, you know, so that the people at the last position in, you know, at the strata of the society, they do get the benefit. But similarly, if you look at, you know, the other economic sectors, specifically infrastructure, I would like to highlight out here, you know, policies like or schemes like Golden Quadrilateral, you know, so these focus on highways, that also seemingly was one foundation which was really important there.
Absolutely. In fact, I think, I'm not sure if Ashok mentioned it or Mr. Iyer mentioned it, the fact that, you know, we took up this massive scheme for the Golden Quadrilateral. Till then, again, there was a feeling within the country, among the elite, that roads are meant for cars and therefore don't bother too much about the roads. Well, good roads are the backbone of economy. You cannot have economic growth if the logistic costs are very high. So you started building this massive Golden Quadrilateral. Fantastic thing. It was, you know, the all four and the phase one, phase two, etc. But then you remembered that a large part of India lives in the villages, right? And economic reforms must touch everybody. And therefore, you went in from the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. So of the cess collected from petrol charges, when you buy petrol, you're paying a cess of 2 rupees, 50 paisa would go towards the Gram Sadak Yojana. End of the day, it is the villager, as I mentioned quickly last time, it is the laborer, the agricultural labor. It is a small and marginal farmer who needs help, who needs better markets. A laborer, if stuck to their own village, will get a lower wages. If he or she can travel 10, 15 kilometers, if there is a road, you would get a completely new set of opportunities available and better wages. Similarly, for the farmer who's selling a produce in smaller quantities. See, a big farmer can hire trucks and tempos and tractors and carry stuff, not the small farmer. And if you have roads coming to the villages, you would have schools and teachers present in schools. You will have primary health workers accessing the village. So, you know, good governance, people think is good files. No, files are important. Files and processes are important. But what is the impact? And therefore, good infrastructure is not a luxury for a developing country, but a good highway, a good rail system, a good rural road system is good for everybody economically. And as Ashok also mentioned, socially, you need social development, you need mobility. You cannot keep people stuck down because they have lack of resources. And I think in that sense, so the first government to really explain and implement a policy of infrastructure development, it's really good for the economy across the board, across the board.
Okay. Mr. Iyer, would you agree out there that this was an holistic effort as far as Mr. Vajpayee's government was concerned on the good governance part and ultimately everything aimed at ensuring deliverables to the common man, the welfare of Aam Aadmi?
Indeed, Vishal, because I do not remember any single sector was left out from, I would say, opening up from reforms. See, I can tell you one thing, the confidence in which the government went about the task for those, particularly between 1999 and 2004, was such that in terms of even the achievements on the ground gave so much of confidence to the BJP to talk of shining India. It is another matter that it did not work out electorally. That was larger due to the performance of the allies of the BJP in the NDA. But the fact that the rank and file at the BJP felt so much of confidence to even think of a Shining India campaign, that means so much had changed between 1998-99 to 2004. So, of course, the most visible were the infrastructure projects. But if you look at the sector-wise development, you know, Tandon G was mentioning about education, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Today, people would say that the HRD ministry, so the leadership of that period, is considered one of the best in terms of the way the basic problems were tackled, whether it was availability of teachers, whether it was getting more children back into the schools, particularly tackling the issue of dropouts. There were both social aspects as well as the economic aspects. And of course, but there was not a single month or a single day when Vajpayee ji did not have a political challenge or a foreign policy challenge or a defense challenge or a security challenge. So therefore, when you look at it, the way the things were then, you know, what I particularly appreciate about Mr. Shakti Sinha's book this time is it has tried to dispel a lot of myth. You know, particularly I'm mentioning this because there was always a feeling, because today when people tend to compare today's period with, you know, what happened then, they seem to think that as if the Vajpayee had it all good or things were, you know, rosy for him. He faced tremendous criticism from the opposition parties, the point which has been brought up by Mr. Shakti Sinha, which as a reporter, I can recall that the very same parties and very same of these very leaders who are today critical of our prime minister were equally harsh on Vajpayee ji. Though today we cannot believe could they have been. But then, you know, but despite all that, and without the majority on the floor of the house, it required so much of deft handling in terms of, you know, passage of bills, because a lot of these changes in the system required legislative concurrence. So given that kind of thing, but Vajpayee ji kept his focus on the goal to be achieved, and he believed in involving and engaging the opposition in dialogue. And despite disagreements at several on several areas, but finally, I think in terms of process outcome, it was a very positive outcome. And that is the reason why today we tend to look back at those period as, I would say, one of the best periods of governance this country has seen. And particularly the other area where the Vajpayee government did exceptionally well was in tackling corruption. In terms of, you know, seeing a lot of decision-making process to an extent where there was less kind of individual discretion at the decision level. Rather, the system started opening up, a point which I feel Prime Minister Modi has further taken it forward.
Okay. Okay, indeed. Let me bring in Mr. Tandon here for the concluding comment. Mr. Tandon, from the way all three of you are describing, how would you sum up, rather, this entire phase of Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee as the Prime Minister of India, the kind of challenges faced by him, and a focused delivery as far as good governance is concerned on all areas, also sort of a holistic, aspect which he looked upon it?
The perfect center-state relations, even with the politically adversary political parties in power. I remember when it was Kaveri dispute, the way he handled it with, at that time, it was Karunanidhi on the one hand, and I think H.J. Patel in Karnataka, and mm-hmm. to bring them together, all these things we witnessed, both me and Shakti Sena, how his persona, his larger than life stature, get respect from a leader of this nature of Karunanidhi, and the Kaveri dispute, the way it was resolved on a number of occasions, not once. And similarly, I must say that on the Jammu and Kashmir issue, the Vajpayee doctrine of resolving the issue of Jammu and Kashmir in the spirit of Kashmiriyat, Jamhuriyat, and Insaniyat, and that is still valid. And that is being repeatedly, quoted by the present Prime Minister Narendra Modi also. So look at the entire, canvas of whether it was center-state relation, whether it was relations with the neighbors, and also the way the opposition was taken into confidence, whether it was the Kargil war, or whether it was attack on parliament, or whether it was hijacking, or all those very sensitive and challenging issues, the entire nation used to be, standing behind Mr. Vajpayee's leadership. I think there cannot be a better description of good governance if we put all these factors together. And that's why I still say the best tribute which Modi government could pay to Vajpayee was to declare his birthday as Good Governance Day. And that the message will continue to be percolating to the subsequent government also. Very rightly, Shekhar has mentioned about transparency in his decision-making, accountability, and zero tolerance of corruption. That is exactly what is being carried forward now in the last 6 years.
Okay, definitely, indeed, marking his birthday as Good Governance Day, as Mr. Tandon is pointing out, is one of the best tributes to him. Thank you so much, Mr. Ashok Tandon, Mr. Shekhar Iyer, as well as Mr. Shakti Sinha, for sharing your views on this aspect. So there it is, all about former Prime Minister late Atal Bihari Vajpayee's tenure, where, as our panelists were pointing out, the entire focus was on delivering good governance to the common man, to Aam Aadmi, looking at holistic development at all sectors and ensuring transparency and accountability as well. We'll come back again tomorrow. Till then, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.